Tonight we'll hopefully complete the third topic, goals and destinations of the Jewish mystics, and may even have time to begin the last topic, namely methods and techniques of the Jewish mystics on reaching those goals. I want to take a look tonight at a number of texts that exemplify the four models that I tried to formulate and delineate in the last couple of meetings. And again, as you remember, these four models were the mystical, theurgical, effective and ecstatic. And I want to take a look at a number of texts that exemplify these models. The first text I want to take a look at, you have in your reader on page 33. And this is an example of the effective model relating to this idea of actions down here drawing down the power, or what in called in Hebrew is the shefa, from above. And as in all of these models, there are literally hundreds of texts that I could have chose from to exemplify them, but I chose certain texts for certain reasons. This text comes, which you see on the top of the page there, I'm taking it from Edel's quotation of it in his book Hasidism, because I like his translation there. This is from a text called in Hebrew the Igeret HaKodesh, which literally means the holy letter. Have any of you ever heard of this text before? You have. Where have you heard of this text before?
I think I heard it from Edel.
Well, you heard it from Edel. Anybody else hear of this text before? Yeah. Where did you hear of it from?
Different teachers. Yeah, reading
from there. Don't any of you go to movies?
No,
this.
It was in that movie, yeah, it was what's her name?
What, Gone with the Wind?
Yeah.
Actually, it was in two movies. I think it's the only Jewish mystical text in two American movies. Any of you know which two American movies?
Oh, Stranger Among Us.
Stranger Among Us with?
I don't know what her name is. Who cares?
Who cares? Melanie Griffith. Married to formerly to Don Johnson. See, people accuse me, including my son and my wife, that I don't know anything about what happened past the 16th century. So I keep watching these things to find out what's going on.
I never have time.
When I started teaching many years ago, there's no common culture in America. There's no frame of reference you can make that everybody will understand, like literature or art or music. So I figured maybe movies and television. So I started watching movies and television. And when I started teaching, I always give examples from movies and television. But now even people don't know movies and television. I had in my class a few years ago, I won't mention the name, a famous film critic based here in Chicago, for one of the networks. No, it wasn't Gene Siskel.
No.
It wasn't Roger Ebert either. But.
Whoa.
And I kept making references to movies, and he kept asking me, oh, you saw that movie? I've always wanted to understand what it is. You know? So, what's the other movie Gerd HaKodesh was in? A trivia question for this evening. Give you a hint. Barbara Streisand.
Yentl.
Don't you remember that scene where she, dressed up as a he, is preparing to get married, and just before the wedding, she's studying a book. Mm-hmm. That's the Igaret HaKodesh. It's a kind of mystical marriage manual.
Yes.
Telling you how to, when to, why to.
And what to say.
It's what to say, what to do, what happens, a whole business. And we don't know who the author is. Traditionally, it is ascribed to the 13th century Spanish Kabbalist called Nachmanides, not to be confused with Maimonides. The I-D-E-S ending simply means son of. So this is Rabbi Moses, son of Nachman, Ben Nachman, who lived in 13th century Spain, but he didn't write this book. It was probably written in Spain, but we're not sure by whom. And it was written probably as a polemic against Christian marriage manuals. All right, I have to give another movie example. Mercure, what's her name? The Greek actress.
Melina Mercury.
What's her most famous movie?
Never on Sunday.
What does Never on Sunday refer to?
Sexual
relations, because it's the Christian Sabbath. Mm-hmm. But never on Friday, because it's the day Jesus died. You know, so they, and almost every day is a saint day, so it's hardly ever. So this, Igaret HaKodesh, is a polemic against those kinds of works, and probably comes from Spain when those kinds of works were very popular.
What is a polemic?
This book. Igaret, in English, literally means a letter, but probably better translated would be kind of monograph. And it's available in English translation, and you can read it. It's also a polemic against Maimonides' views on human sexuality, because Maimonides, following Aristotle, had very negative views on human sexuality.
What does polemic mean?
What does polemic mean? An argument against.
Thank you.
So, here you have the text.
I like it.
Human thought has the ability to strip itself of the alien issues and to ascend to and arrive at the place of its source. Then it will unite with the supernal entity, namely the entity above, when it comes. And it, namely the thought, and it, namely its source, become one entity. In other words, the thing, the thought, and the thing you're thinking about become one entity. And when one's thought returns downward from above, so you see, first the thought goes up, and then it comes back down. Something similar to a line appears. And with it, the supernal light descends under the influence of the thought that draws it down. So the supernal light, meaning the light above, the divine power, if you will, is drawn down by the thought that comes from below. So the thought from below goes up and draws itself back down, and with it, the supernal light, the divine light. And consequently, it draws the Shekhinah down. It draws God's power, God's providence, God's presence down to our world from the upper world. Then the brilliant light comes and increases upon the place where the owner of the thought stands. So the person who generates the thought is literally enlightened. And since this is the case, our ancient sages had to state that when the husband copulates with his wife and his thought unites with the supernal entities, that very thought draws the supernal light downward, and it, namely the supernal light, dwells upon the drop of semen upon which he directs his intention and thought. Since the thought on it, namely the drop of semen, is linked to the supernal entities, it draws the brilliant light downward. So here you have the idea that the most physical of actions, sexual relations, can be used as an example of the affective model, because the action during the sexual relations, both the thought and the physical coupling, sort of have an impact above and then draw down the divine power from above to below. In the theurgic model, you would have, which you have hints of here, the idea would be that the sexual coupling of the man and woman down below would cause the harmony of the male and female emanations, probably Tiferet and Shekhinah, up above. So in other words, in the theurgic model, the action down here below becomes the model or the paradigm that brings the parallel effect above. So if it's an action of coupling, it'll bring about, of the male and female forces below, it'll bring about a coupling of the male and female forces above. In the affective model, the action here below not only has an effect above, but also brings down, draws down the divine grace, power, whatever you want to call it, stuff from above to have an effect on us here. So the reason I chose this is first that I wanted you to know about this text, Igeret HaKodesh, if you don't go to movies or if you do. And secondly, because here you have an example of a theme that later becomes very prominent in Hasidism, the last great phase of Jewish mysticism, which is that the most physical of actions can have the most spiritual of results. Because what more spiritual of a result can you have than the ability to draw, as it says, to draw Shekhinah, to draw the divine down from above to below. So the most physical of actions, done with the right intentions, can produce the most spiritual of results and have an impact on our world, on our situation.
Done with the right intentions.
Well, the right intentions is to bring about this exact result. The intentions geared toward the result, which is to bring down the divine power from above.
You mean to say that this tells us that during the sexual coupling, they are supposed to be thinking about bringing down the divine from above?
Only he.
Only he.
But it says only, it says he, it doesn't say she.
So what's she supposed to be doing?
He's not thinking about himself at all?
That's the idea.
Why is that the idea?
Because that's the only way you can have the desired effect. Now your question is a very good one too. What about her? In the Igeret HaKodesh, you find the theme very strongly that the obligation of the male in sexual relations is the satisfaction of the female. That's his obligation. So she doesn't have any obligation. You see, because the commandment to be fruitful and multiply in Jewish law is only on the male. That's why Jewish law allows for female birth control techniques, but discourages male birth control techniques. Because the commandment to be fruitful and multiply is given to the male, not to the female. That's why men are obliged in Jewish law to marry, women are not.
That's interesting. Hmm.
Don't tell that to Jewish mothers, women are not.
Right, but I didn't know that the women are allowed to use birth control.
That's not in the movies. It's in Jewish law.
I didn't know that was an accepted.
It's accepted under certain circumstances. I don't want to go into all exposition now of what the circumstances may be, but...
If she's sick.
No, you have other exceptions, too. Yes. Now, if you think this is racy, take a look at page 35 in the brochure, where you have a selection from the Zohar. Yeah, on the top of the page. This selection is from the Zohar, and it relates to the celebration of the Passover Seder. I mean, here is a regular ritual, nothing, you know, unusual. And today in America, probably the most widely observed Jewish ritual, the Passover Seder, probably observed by American Jews more than any other Jewish ritual. And here's how they interpret one aspect of it. Put on your seatbelt. In the Passover Seder, it is traditional to drink how many cups of wine?
Four.
You know why?
In order to get drunk and...
No, that's Purim.
Yeah, but to be merry, no?
No, you're mixing holidays. I once was wondering, what if you brought somebody who's not Jewish into a synagogue and their only exposure was Purim? So people getting drunk, making noise. Okay, please.
There are four different words used in the Bible to describe God's taking the children of Israel out of Egypt.
Right, and there are four, and for each of those we have one cup. According to some authorities, there are five, and there is a custom amongst some to drink five. But the normative one is to drink four.
Four
cups of wine. So this is what this text is discussing. Rabbi Yossi said, why do we have four cups of wine on this night? Why do we drink four cups of wine at the Passover Seder? The interpretation you have in the Talmud is the one just given, namely you have four different what are called words of redemption in the Bible, and each of these words denotes, is symbolized by a different one of the cups of wine. But here you're going to have a totally different explanation altogether, relating, of course, as you probably guessed, to the Sfirot. Now, while we're on the question of the Sfirot in Passover, let me add something here, and that is that on the table in Passover, what do you have? Seder plate. Now, what's on the Seder plate?
Bone.
All right, so you have the bone, the herbs, yeah, 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 that's the bitter herbs.
The bitter herbs and the charoset.
Not on the plate.
No.
There's something missing.
One more thing. Salt water.
Not on the plate.
Not on the plate either. The roast
lamb. No, it's not on the plate. Give up?
Horseradish
is here.
Is there another green vegetable?
Yes. The other green vegetable is?
Lettuce.
Is lettuce. Let me stop here and add a footnote. You may never have seen lettuce on a Seder plate. In the Talmud, the sixth thing on the Seder plate, or one of the things on the Seder plate, is lettuce. In the Talmud, the word chazeret refers to romaine lettuce.
Chazeret?
Is romaine lettuce. In the Mishnah. Now, no. Now, the problem was that in Europe, particularly Northern Europe, they didn't have romaine lettuce. You know, you try to find some romaine lettuce in Lithuania in the 17th century. You know, you can't go down to Dominic's or, you know, food store and say, give me some romaine lettuce. So they started substituting something that they had. So probably most of you saw, if you have European, or if your family is European, you have potatoes or something, because everybody had potatoes, right? Everybody had potatoes. So they often use potatoes, but actually it's romaine lettuce.
Okay. Romaine lettuce?
Yes. Specifically romaine lettuce, yes. Now, it's the spring, for the spring, holiday of the spring. It's called in the Bible Chag Ha'aviv, the holiday of the spring.
Parsley
you need for the crossings.
And the egg?
The egg is the temple. I'm not getting into all that. The point is that you have six things, right? Now, somebody mentioned before the matzah. How many pieces of matzah do you have on the little things? Three pieces. So here's the idea. Each of these things represents one of the sfirot. The three pieces of matzah represent the upper three sfirot. The six things on the plate represent the next six sfirot. And the plate itself represents the Shekhinah, because the Shekhinah is the reflection of all of the above of the Sefirot. Now, when you go to the store, say a gift shop, you want to buy somebody a Seder plate. Most of them are the same, right? Mm-hmm. But they're the same because they follow a certain configuration on the plate of these different six things. Mm-hmm. Where does that configuration come from? From Luria. The configuration of the things on the plate mostly follow the tradition of Rabbi Isaac Luria, the 16th century Kabbalist. There are other configurations, but the one that has become standardized has been the one of the Kabbalists, particularly the one of the Lurianic Kabbalists. And each of the things on the plate are put in a certain place because each of them correspond to one or another of the sfirot. So for example, in the middle of the plate are the bitter herbs, maror, representing the sfirat tiferet.
Tiferet.
The three matzot represent the upper three emanations, the crown, chachma, and bina. And then the egg is over here, representing din, or justice. The shank bone over here, representing chesed, or divine love, or grace. The karpas, or parsley, representing majesty, or hod. The haroset over here, representing netzach, or eternity. The lettuce over here, representing yesod, foundation. So each of the things represents one of the sfirot. The plate itself represents Shekhinah. The three matzot represent the upper sfirot. And you have 10. And the idea is that when you use each of those things, because each of these things are used somewhere along the way, or referred to somewhere along the way, you are sort of making an impulse above in the world of the sfirot.
I missed the herbs.
The herbs are tiferet, and they're in the middle of the plate. Now back to our text. Rabbi Abba replied, the companions, these are of course the other Kabbalists, the companions have already explained that they correspond to the four terms for redemption. So that's following the Talmudic view that there are four terms describing the redemption of the Jews from Egypt, and each of the four cups refers to one of these four terms for redemption. But there is also a fine interpretation in the book of Rabbi Yessa Saba. So this is some Kabbalistic book, which states that it is because sacred intercourse occurs on this night. In other words, the reason we drink the four cups of wine at the Seder has a deeper meaning than each one of them referring to one of the four words for redemption. The deeper meaning is that somehow drinking the four cups of wine brings about the sacred intercourse, in other words, the intercourse amongst the Sfirot. And I would say that if you look in the Zohar, you will find that this is true for the Zohar of all the holidays, all the Jewish holidays, just about. In other words, the purpose of the observance of the holidays, the deeper purpose, is to have an effect on the upper world. That's what the theurgical school is all, view is all about. And the things we do on the holidays, the particular rituals and prayers and everything else we do, are aimed at having that effect above. And that effect above is symbolized by the intercourse either between the Tiferet and Shekhinah or amongst the various male and female emanations, the Sfirot above. So here, as you can guess already, since we have four cups, four of the Sfirot are involved. So, why is this night different from all other nights? You know, as it says in the Passover Seder, because four of the Sfirot, if you do the Seder the right way, experience the sacred intercourse. In other words, you bring about the unification of the male and female forces within the divine. So, because of the sacred intercourse occurs on this night, and it takes place by means of four bonds. Four bonds are the four Sfirot which we're talking about here. And the four Sfirot we're talking about here are Netzach, Hod, Yesod, and Malchut. The lower four. So it's these three and this. Okay? So those are the four of the Sfirot that drinking the four cups bring together in the sacred intercourse. That is four levels which are not separated from one another. So through the ritual of the Passover Seder, which isn't anything unusual, isn't anything, you know, isn't some involved mystical technique, is a normal, regular, observed Jewish ritual by everybody. If you do it with the proper intentions, it brings about a unification of the male and female forces above, and in particular, the four emanations, majesty, eternity, foundation, Yesod, and Malchut. When this intercourse takes place, we too are aroused through their joy. Since we have already made contact with them, for whoever is connected with one has access to all. In other words, through that you have access to the upper world, to the divine world. And now they answer the question, why is this night different from all other nights? Therefore, this night is different from all other nights, And we must effect changes in everything. In other words, we effect what happens above and rejoice in this night. Why do we rejoice? Because we have achieved, through these actions, a unification of the male and female forces above. Because there is rejoicing both above and below. There's rejoicing above because you have the reunification, and there's rejoicing below because we have achieved the reunification. He also said that we call these four, namely the four cups, the four redemptions. In other words, the four words of redemption. Why? Because the last level, what's the last level? Malchut, right? Because the last level is called Redeemer, the angel that redeems. And she is called Redeemer also because of another higher level that is suited above her and illumines her. In other words, Shekhinah is redeemed because she's reunited with the upper emanations. We are redeemed, and that's what Passover is, the holiday of redemption, because God's presence in the world, Malchut, is activated, the flow comes down, and achieves our redemption. That which is situated above her illumines her. In other words, the Sefirot above her, above Malchut, are activated, and the flow comes down and illumines her, enters her. And this provides her with light only through the two levels that are above it. So she is illumined by what comes from above. So we see that these four are the four redemptions. In other words, the four redemptions are referring to the four Sefirot. Is that... And Netzach, Hod, Yesod, and Malchut are four. Is that more or less clear? You get what's going on here? Mm. Yes or no?
Yes.
All right. Do you see the sexual symbolism in here? Do you see the explicit sexual symbolism in here? Mm-hmm. Yes. Malchut is what?
The female. But it's the Shekhinah.
In terms of explicit sexual symbolism.
The womb.
The womb. Yesod is?
The penis.
And Netzach and Hod? Yep.
What?
Testicles. You couldn't be more explicit than that. Mm-hmm. So in other words, the action here below stimulates the male apparatus up here. It gets moving, flows down into Malchut, and through Malchut, then down to us.
In other words, sexual intercourse when a couple...
In other words, this is more interesting than Jewish philosophy.
But when they're coupling, this goes on above them?
This has nothing to do here.
Going on.
Wait, you're mixing texts. The text that we read before, the Igaret HaKodesh, yes. This text is not talking about human beings doing anything other than drinking four cups of wine at the Passover Seder. There's no sexual business going on down here in this text. It's just talking about going through the Passover Seder.
Okay.
Here is another business altogether. Here, you're talking about a sexual relationship going on down here that then brings down a force from above and creates a certain effect above.
Right, but if we don't drink four cups of wine.
Yeah, that's the flip side. In other words, this is precise, I'm glad you mentioned that. This is precisely why, see, people often say the Jewish mystics were sort of anti-Jewish law. It's the opposite is the truth. They were very meticulous about Jewish law because each act that you do has an effect above. And if you don't know the law correctly, and you don't observe the law correctly, it'll either have no effect, or the wrong effect, or a bad effect above. That's why the last authoritative code of Jewish law, the Shulchan Aruch, written in the 16th century by Joseph Caro. Joseph Caro was a mystic. He was part of the Lurianic group. Because if you have the idea that each and every act, each and every gesture you do, whether it's observing the rituals like the Passover Seder or sexual relations, each and every act and gesture that you do has an impact above. In other words, it influences not only yourself, not only other people, not only your society, not only the cosmos, but it impacts on God, on the divine world, then every act you do is extraordinarily important and has to be done in a very precise and right way. And therefore, if you do not interpret, say, Jewish law correctly, then you prescribe an action which does not have the right effects or has the wrong effects. And the flip side is also true, because you raised the issue of what if you don't do this right. Then you have the other side, which is these are the, say, Passover Seder is the fulfillment of a commandment. Here in the sexual relations, it's you know, you're not commanded to have sexual relations. So it's a kind of anomian thing beyond the law. But then you have the flip side, which is sin. The idea is that sin, just as doing the commandments in the right way bring about the unification above, sin brings about a disunification above. In other words, that sin has the impact of disrupting the divine forces, of disrupting the balance amongst the male and female forces above, disturbing the flow down, imbalancing the flow down, and having the impact of affecting God in a negative way. So the idea of the Zohar, say, on sin is that sin not only messes us up and messes the world up, it messes God up. And it weakens the power, sin, weakens the power of the Shekhinah in the world and allows the Sitra Achra, the other side, the demonic side, to get power over the Shekhinah, because if God's power in the world is weakened and lessened, then the Shekhinah becomes more vulnerable to the forces of evil. The immune system sort of breaks down, and then God's power in our world is weakened, and then we're in big trouble. So our job is to do good deeds that are good, that will strengthen God's presence in the world, the Shekhinah, that will bring about the unification amongst the Sfirot and will keep the balance of the male and female forces intact. So here you have a view central to the Jewish mystics that the human being, far from being irresponsible, far from being detached from moral responsibility, it's the opposite. The Jewish mystics have the view that the human being has tremendous power because every action that each person does has the potential of having an effect on the divine itself. What more power could a person have than making an impact on God? And so in this view, you again have this, in the theurgic view, you again have this idea of the medieval mystics, which they used, which they called by the Hebrew term tzorach gavoha, divine need. In other words, God needs us to do the right things, to bring about the right results in the divine world. It's not simply that we do the rituals, you know, for some sociological reason or some, you know, ethnic reason. We do the rituals because, in this view, it has an effect on the upper world.
Out in Hebrew, the divine need.
Divine Sorach gavoha. Sorach is need. Gavoha means literally on high. The need of the one on high. You find it, I think, beginning in the 13th century, but you find the idea much earlier. The term you find beginning, I think, in the 13th century. Now, let me just read to you one other text that you don't have.
But all it says is high need.
That's all it has to say. It's what it means, more important than what it says. Let me quote you another text, which you don't have, which describes the high holidays. Here you had an example of Passover. Let me give you another text from the Zohar on the high holidays. Rabbi Chiya said, I should like to discuss the days between Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year, and the last days of the festival of Sukkot, namely Shmini Atzeret. Rabbi Eliezer replies, although the companions have already explained the matter, and that is correct, the arrangement of these days is a mystery of wisdom among the Kabbalists. This concealed mystery is the order of unification, which means that the days in question, namely the days between Rosh Hashanah and the end of the holiday of Sukkot, are stages in the process of the intercourse between the Holy One, blessed be He, and the Shekhinah. In other words, they view the time frame from the Jewish New Year, Rosh Hashanah, till the end of the holiday of Sukkot as a process of divine, of unification of Tiferet and Malchut, of Tiferet and the Shekhinah. So again here, you have the idea that the observance of the Jewish holidays is to make an impact above and to bring about the sacred intercourse between the male and the female forces. And I don't want to read the whole text, but in this text they also suggest something very common, very similar to the Igaret HaKodesh, that the intercourse going on down here between the male and the female is what stimulates the intercourse that eventually goes on up there between Tiferet and Shekhinah.
Sukkot is not a full moon. You said the Shekhinah is a full moon. Because this is the moon, right?
That's another symbol system, yes. Shekhinah is the moon and Tiferet is the sun. But let me give you, since you raised that issue, let me give you an example of how you have already in the Talmud roots of these ideas. Because I don't want you to think that these are just some, you know, ideas the Kabbalists thought up by themselves that have no continuity with anything that came before. In the Talmud, you have a tract, you know, the Talmud is divided into tractates, and one of those tractates is called Chulin. And I think it's on page 60 there. If you look it up, I'll have to check, I think 60B. You have the following discussion. There's a discussion in the Bible, in the Torah, about sacrifices, what sacrifices you bring on different occasions. And it says there, I think it's in the book of Numbers, that on the occasion of the new moon, you bring a sin offering. You bring a sin offering. And the Hebrew word used there is for a sin offering is kapara. That's the same word that like Yom Kippur comes from. Kapara, a sin offering. It says, Heviu kapara elai. Bring a sin offering to me. So in other words, God says, on the occasion of the new moon, bring a sin offering, that kind of sacrifice, to me. Okay. Now, here's how the Talmud explains that verse, bring a sin offering to me on the occasion of the new moon. What does the new moon have to do with sin? And here's their interpretation. It's really, I think, one of the most startling passages in the Talmud. They translate the verse that I just quoted to you, Heviu kapara elai, bring a sin offering to me, as Heviu Kapara Ali, bring a sin offering on my behalf. And then it says like this. In the Bible we read that in the Genesis story, that God created two great lights, the sun and the moon. And it says, what's going on here? Just look outside. You only see one great light, the sun. How come it says in the Bible God created two great lights, the sun and the moon, when we only have now one great light and one little light? So the Talmud says like this. Originally, God created two great lights, the sun and the moon, as the Bible says. Then the two great lights, the sun and the moon, they were equal, came to God and they said, two kings cannot wear one crown. In other words, one of us has to be the great light and the other one not the great light. So God, the Talmud says, shrunk the moon. Made the moon small.
Why the moon?
She was the one that complained.
Well, maybe.
Well, that's in legend that the moon complained. But you're
well, obviously it's in legend.
But you're saying.
I'm quoting a text. Don't bug me with, you know, as it says, Al Makshin Al Ha'agadah. You don't ask rational questions of these texts. The moon, they complained, both complained.
Complain,
yes.
Right.
Depends which reading you have.
You've got to have a reason for the moon being made smaller.
No. In some of the texts it says they complained.
Okay.
I'm not taking, see the Talmud doesn't take this argument because then the moral of the story would be, see if you complain you get zapped.
Right.
That's not their moral of the story. But there are different readings, and I'm using the reading says they complained. So the moon is diminished. So why is the moon shrunken? Taking not this reading that the moon complained. No reason. It's unjust. So the text says, Talmud. This is Talmud, not, you know, some Kabbalistic text. Says, God sinned against the moon because he unjustly diminished the size of the moon. Moon didn't do anything. Therefore, he says in the Bible, Heviu Kapara Alai, bring an atonement sacrifice for me. And here I would say you have two extraordinary theological ideas. Number one, God sins. God sins. No, that's not the second one. The second extraordinary theological idea is we make atonement for God. In other words, bring the sin offering not for your sin, for my sin. So in other words, we, again, it's the Humpty Dumpty story. God is in disarray. And we patch them together. In other words, on one level, God redeems us because we need redemption because we sin. But it also works the other way. God sins. God makes mistakes. God screws up. And we repair God's sin. And you find, I can give you other texts where you find this idea. I'll give you a simple one, Hasidic text. The great Hasidic master who lived in the Ukraine in the 19th century, Lev Yitzchak of Berdichev, took the word Yom HaKippurim. Now, Yom HaKippurim is translated Day of Atonement, but it's in the plural in Hebrew, in the Bible. Yom HaKippurim, the Day of Atonements, right? So already in the Talmud, they raise the question, why is it in the plural? And they say, well, the reason is it refers to two kinds of sins. One is the sins we commit against God, and the other is the sins we commit against other human beings. Lev Yitzchak of Berdichev interprets it this way. It refers to two kinds of sin: the sins we commit against God and the sins God commits against us. But the Talmud goes further, because Talmud says, okay, God has sins, but it's our obligation to repent of God's sins.
He gets off free.
Maybe.
It gives human beings the right to be angry at God if they can atone for his sins.
It gives us the right to get angry at God. We have the right without the Talmud, this text. And we can get angry. Why not?
The world is unfair.
That what?
That the world is unfair.
Well, whoever said it is fair. I mean, this is, seems to me, an American predilection. To think that things should be fair is an Anglo-Saxon predilection. Who says? What's the word for fair in classical Hebrew? You go to Israel today, they say, "Ze lo fair." It's not fair. There's no word fair.
Right.
Americans, everything has to be fair. God doesn't have to play fair, you know. He's not playing cricket.
No. They say it's not fair. And they understand the concept.
Well, they're under the British too long. Let me give you another example, one more example of the theurgical, which you don't have in your packet. The most central prayer in the Jewish liturgy is called the Kedusha prayer, sanctification prayer. And this prayer is based upon an idea of a vision of God had by the prophets Isaiah and Ezekiel. And central in this prayer is the verse in Isaiah, chapter 6, verse 3, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, the whole world is full of his glory." So, in the same tractate I just quoted to you, Chulin, a page later from the story I just told you, you have the following text. Again, I want to show you this text because it again exemplifies how these ideas are rooted in the rabbinic literature. That they're not, you know, simply invented by the mystics with no earlier continuity. Text Chulin 91b, "Israel is more beloved by God than the heavenly hosts," than the angels. "For while Israel sings praises to God at every hour and any time, the angels are permitted to sing in the heavens only when Israel sings on the earth." In other words, again, this very fundamental idea of the Kabbalists, the theurgical idea, what happens below affects what happens above. In other words, even the angels, or especially the angels, aren't allowed to sing praises to God until we are doing it here below. In other words, the flow doesn't go, the angels start singing and then we start singing. It's the opposite. Until the action starts here below, until the prayers start here below, even the angels are not permitted to sing songs of praise to God. The angels are not allowed to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts," until the people first say it below. So when Isaiah sees, according to this text, sees the angels standing around God's throne, singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts," he knows, according to this text, that the people below have already or are simultaneously doing it, because the angels can't start unless it happens below. Now let me give you just one other example.
That's why we hear music in the movies.
Maybe, I don't know. Let me give you one other... Now, I don't think it's this kind of coupling. Don't mix coupling with popcorn. They didn't have popcorn. Let me give you a text. If you would read it in the Talmud the first time, you would think it's the stupidest text you could imagine. or as we'd call in Yiddish, a klutz kasha, an idiot question. But let me give you this example again as a Talmudic referent for precedence for these ideas. In Isaiah's vision of God and the angels, in Isaiah chapter 6, any of you know how many wings the angels have?
Six.
Each angel has six wings, right? Now, Ezekiel, in chapter 1 and 2 of the book of Ezekiel, also has a vision of God on his throne, and also sees angels. And the angels also have wings. How many wings do they have?
Four.
So now the Talmud, in the tractate called Chagigah, Chagigah raises the following question. What's the question? That's the beginning question. The real question is, if both of the prophets, Isaiah and Ezekiel, saw the same thing, namely God on his throne surrounded by the angels, then how come in Isaiah's vision the angels had six wings and in Ezekiel's vision the angels had four wings? And then the further question the Talmud asks. In Isaiah's vision it says angel had six wings. Two, they covered their face so they couldn't see God. Two, they covered their body out of modesty. And two, they flew. So if the angels in Ezekiel's vision were missing two wings, which two wings did they take away?
The flying.
Well, they don't resolve it. But here's the issue. How come the angels have fewer wings? And the Talmud's answer is, and this I think you have another example of a roots of the liturgy of the theurgical view, developed much more by the Kabbalists. The Talmud answers this question: why were the number of wings of the angels diminished? Their answer is, Isaiah saw this vision before the destruction of the temple. And Ezekiel saw this vision, he lived after the destruction of the temple. In other words, the destruction of the temple down here has an effect up there, in that God's heavenly hosts, God's angels, God's, you know, groupies, or whatever you want to call them, are diminished, are lessened by the fact of the destruction of the temple down here. In other words, a catastrophe down here in this world also brings about a catastrophe, a lessening, a weakening of the powers up there. In other words, just as the good stuff that happens down here strengthens up there, the bad stuff down here weakens up there. And this they symbolize by the reduction of the angels that surround God on the throne by two wings. It's already, I would say, in the writings of the prophets. Because the prophets kept saying, if you don't repent, it's all going to be destroyed. And the fact that the prophets said that was, in effect, a heresy at that time, because the assumption going was that the city of David, Jerusalem, and the temple are inviolate, that they could not be destroyed, and that they would always remain in Jewish hands.
So that's constantly with the assumption that God is perfect and all-powerful, which is...
No, powerful. I wouldn't say all-powerful. The assumption is that he is just, not all-powerful. The assumption is that the people sin, there is a punishment. Let me give you the liturgical view on this, because the liturgical view for me is very problematic, though it seems to be very almost normative. You have the phrase in the liturgy, Mipnei chataenu galinu me'artzenu, because of our sins, we're exiled from our land. In other words, because of our sins, the temple is destroyed and we're sent into the exile, right? So in other words, when we sin, we are punished. Right? Now what about when good things happen? Take, for example, the holiday of Purim or the holiday of Hanukkah. What does the liturgy say there?
God did a miracle for us.
In other words, it wasn't because we did anything good. It's God did the miracle for us. So it's heads I win, tails you lose, right? If something good happens, now God, I did it. If something bad happens, well, you screwed up. So it's a no-win view.
Because it's God's story.
No, it's not God's story. It's worse. It's the rabbi's story. You see, I'm suggesting to you that they produced a theology that we have to sort of figure out an alternative to, and the Kabbalists give us alternatives to. And I think that some of these views of the Kabbalists were developed in order to give alternatives to the more usual theology, because the more usual theology is going to make you nuts. Let me give you an example. I won't mention the movie with Tony Perkins. Anthony Perkins, the trial, Kafka. But what about the story, the trial by Kafka? What is the story of the trial? Kafka's this trial. Any of you ever read it?
No.
See the movie?
No.
My God, I should go back to referring to movies. It's about a man who is on trial, who didn't commit a crime, and is punished for a crime. They never tell him what it is that he didn't commit. That's the Kafka's story of the trial. Now, Kafka had a best friend who was also a novelist in Prague by the name of Max Brod. And Kafka on his deathbed said to Max Brod, "Max, burn everything." Brod didn't listen. So we have Kafka's work. And Brod interpreted the story of the trial in a very important way for Jews. He said, this was Kafka's one story that was for him the summary of all of Jewish history. In other words, people getting punished on trial and suffering, and they don't know why, and they don't know what they did wrong. So let me give you an example. If you come home, say you have a very expensive Chinese rug, $50,000 Chinese rug, and you have a little kid at home, and the kid spills ink, knows you shouldn't do this thing like this, indelible ink all over your $50,000 Chinese rug. So if you come home, kid says, "Hi mom, hi dad," you look at the ink on the rug, and if you're not a very enlightened parent, you say,
"Who did this?"
No, you say, "You did this?" Wham! Today would be child abuse, but you know. Wham. Now, take another scenario. You come home, kid runs to the door, "Hi mommy, hi daddy, hi kid," wham! Kid says, "What'd you do that for?" And you say, "You know why. You know what you did." Now that's immediate way of creating a neurotic child. Because if the kid did something wrong and they know they're being punished for what they did wrong, okay, I can buy it. But if you say to the kid, you know, "Here's your punishment," and the kid says, "Why are you punishing me?" And you say, "You know why," you're going to make the kid be guilt-ridden. He'll be thinking, why did they do this to me? I don't deserve it. I must have done something wrong, otherwise they didn't do it to me. And then they'll start inventing things they did wrong to justify your punishment of them. This is Kafka's The Trial. And this is Kafka's, according to Brod's, interpretation of Jewish history. That the people are suffering. So they say, since God is just, and this suffering is a punishment, God wouldn't allow us to suffer for no reason, so it must be that we did something wrong. Since we can't figure out what it is we did wrong that would justify such a punishment, we have to Subconsciously, you eventually invent something that you did wrong to justify the punishment. And this has been the standard interpretation of all catastrophe in Jewish history until the Holocaust. Holocaust, Jewish theologians finally said, look, there's no sin that could justify this, so there must be something else. Hasn't come up yet, no one has come up yet with an explanation, but the rejection of that approach, which leads you to neurotic guilt syndrome, was very important. But what I'm suggesting is that even long before the Holocaust, with the Kabbalists already, even in the Talmud already, like this business with the moon, the suggestion is that if a catastrophe occurs, it's not always our fault. And therefore, we don't have to get neurotically guilty about it. There are other alternative explanations. To why bad things happen. Did I ever explain to you my theory of the High Holiday Liturgy?
No.
No? You have the High Holidays, Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, right? So the idea is God has a book, right? And he writes in this book. What does he write?
Your name.
He knows your name. What else does he write?
What your faith will be.
Based on what?
What you've done in your life.
What you've done. So you have a book. God has a book. All right? And each one of us has a page in this book. On the page, what kind of page is it? It's an accounting ledger. That's what kind of page God's book is, an accounting ledger. One side of the ledger are what? All our credits. One side of the ledger, all our debts. So good things we do and bad things we do. Virtues and sins. Now, what's the assumption of the high holiday season?
That we've sinned.
Worse than, better than that, or depends how you look at it. That we have more of these than we have of these.
Right.
In other words, to put it in simple, straight accounting terms, we're running at a deficit.
Right.
We're running at a deficit. We have more sins than we have virtues.
But that's not true for most people. In the synagogue and read all of these sins and I say, you know, that can't be me. I didn't do all of these sins.
That's why they're in the first person plural. Besides, you don't know what's going on with all these other people. They look very nice and well-dressed, you know, but you don't know what else is going on there. So the assumption is we need to repent on the high holidays because we're running at a deficit. We have more deficits than credit. Now, and the whole Jewish people, of course, are also running at a deficit because you add up all the pages and you have a big deficit at the end of the year. Now, how do you deal with deficit spending?
Print money.
They can't, this isn't money. How do you deal with this? One way to deal with it is increase your income line, right? So how do you increase your income line? Remember the liturgy. Tshuva. Tefillah, utzdakah, ma'avirin, and roa hagzerah. Prayer, repentance, and good deeds avert the evil decree. The evil decree is based on your negative balance. So if you do repentance, charity, and good deeds, then you add to your income line, and you have a chance at balancing your budget. Now, it's already Yom Kippur. Ready Yom Kippur, and you don't know if your budget is balanced yet, if your books are balanced. You may still be running at a deficit. All your prayers, you know, you still may be at a deficit.
So you give charity.
What do? You've already given the charity. You've already said the prayers. You're moving to the Musaf, the additional service on Yom Kippur. And what do you have there in the Musaf service? The martyrology. And what's the martyrology got to do with this?
Oh, we get the credits from our ancestors.
That's it. In other words, the idea is The idea is that all of the martyrs of the past, all of the saints and the ancestors and all of these, they provided us with a huge endowment fund. Huge endowment fund. Look at all the martyrs we had. I mean, martyrs were very rich in. So these martyrs, why are they martyrs? They died, we say in Hebrew, Al Kiddush Hashem, for the sanctification of God's name. They died for him, for God. So we have a huge endowment fund. We can make a withdrawal from the endowment fund, credit it to our deficit position, and this endowment fund is so huge, we can make withdrawals, we don't only have to take the interest, we can invade it, and it's never diminished. And that's how we balance the account. So it's a strict accounting theology. And for the Kabbalists, it was too prosaic. They could not conceive of God like H&R Block or something like this. God could not be conceived as simply, you know, sitting, making accounting ledgers for us. They needed something more complex, more subtle, more involved, more theologically sophisticated. So they gave us all this other stuff. But the standard view is this view. Something people can understand. It's very simple. Yeah, you were first.
So then it relates to the idea that if we've done something wrong, if we die during the year, it's because we committed sins.
Yes.
Not because our time has come?
No. That's why, ultimately, you can't explain it. So you need alternatives. And the same thing with catastrophes. This isn't enough. You can't explain a thing like, you know, a catastrophe like Khmelnytsky massacres or Holocaust or destruction of the temple with this. That's the whole question the Talmud raises, getting back to her question. Because her question was, why did the temple was destroyed? Where do you find it? Well, you find it in the prophets that say if the people sin, and we warned them already, the temple will be destroyed. So the first temple was destroyed. But the Talmud says, we're living in this time, first century, second century, the second temple was destroyed. They said, okay, the first temple was destroyed. The prophet said, if you don't shape up, you don't repent, the temple is going to be destroyed. So they didn't repent, the temple was destroyed. But they said, the Talmud, the second temple, it was a period of a righteous generation. So in a wicked generation, okay. But a righteous generation, why should the temple be destroyed? They couldn't find an explanation. And if you go through the whole rabbinic literature, you will not find that they are able to explain why the temple was destroyed. You cannot find them finding a sin that would justify such a catastrophe. So they have to come up with alternative explanations. And one of the things the Kabbalists do is to provide that. With the idea that you have the filter down, the grape juice business I gave you, the idea that you can't make the omelet without breaking the eggs, the Humpty Dumpty. I mean, all of these things are, besides everything else, attempts to give you alternative views to the normative or the standard theological explanation. Because they found the normative or standard theological explanation to be too simplistic. People do not want to have a relationship with God who is an accountant. They don't want such a God. So they had to have an explanation. So, wouldn't you prefer to view, say, Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur by this text I just read you is the sacred intercourse and all this stuff, than to view it as, you know, accounting ledgers. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe some of you like accounting ledgers, you know. Okay, yes, sir.
You answered it. I'm looking at this accounting procedure, and I keep thinking it can't really stand by itself. But you just answered it, that over there is the key to that.
I wouldn't say the key. I would say it's a supplement. Okay. It's a complement or an alternative.
But it struck me that the idea came to, in fact, show this accounting system, which on the surface would be rejected.
Would be what?
Rejected by whom? By whom?
By those who heard it from somebody else.
No, I don't think so. I think that to many people this would make a lot of sense because it's tangible, quantifiable, and simple.
Yeah, I know what bothers me. You mentioned, what is the word, activistic.
Mm-hmm.
But where is the active part in it? What do we do?
Oh, with this?
Yeah.
Oh, we do everything. In other words, in this...
No, we are drawing from the endowment fund.
Well, that's after you've already done all your stuff during the year, good stuff and bad stuff.
You're still in a deficit.
After you've tried during the high holiday season to do prayer and repentance and good deeds, after all that, the assumption is you still may be running at a deficit. Maybe. So it's very activistic. It's very proactive here and here. It's just you need the balance. Now, I didn't tell you the end of the story. The end of the story, according to the Talmud, is that at the end of Yom Kippur, it says each person should assume that their account is perfectly balanced. What does that mean? And that the whole world is perfectly balanced. In other words, the books are perfectly balanced. What does it mean? It means the next deed you do, the next minute after Yom Kippur ends, can throw the whole world off balance. Because if you have one good deed, well, then that shifts the whole accounting for the whole world to the credit side. If you have one bad deed, it throws everything to the deficit side. So again, pardon me?
Until the end of the year.
But the idea is the moral implication here. The moral implication here is that the individual, again, already in the Talmud, not even to the mystics, already the idea is the human being has tremendous responsibility. In other words, we don't say, oh, you know, it's our nature to sin, you know, and we can't help it. And we need an external redeemer to come and save us. No. Here you have a different view altogether. We say everything is dependent on what we do, even God. See, they don't let human beings off the hook. Maybe God gets a little off the hook, but human beings don't get off the hook. The human being is ultimately responsible for everything. So it's a very high view of the human being. And I would say it's very different than other religious traditions and very different than many philosophical traditions. Okay, any questions on any of this? All right, we'll take a little break now, and then we'll take a look at the text, completing topic 3. Now I want to take a look at a number of texts. I'm going to spend a lot of time next session on the ecstatic by discussing with you Abulafi and all this, so I don't want to take any example of the texts that exemplify the ecstatic model. We've already seen texts exemplifying the affective model. I want to take some for the mystical model and a few more for the theurgical, because the theurgical is really the dominant model that you have running throughout the Kabbalistic literature. The first text, I'm sorry, let me put it another way. The mystical model, we already took a look at text. I want to take a look at one text for the ecstatic model that will link our discussion tonight with the discussion next time. And that you find on page 23. This is a translation of a selection from a book called Shushan Sodot, and it's quoted from manuscript, which is a better edition than the printed version. This book, Shushan Sodot, was written by a person who was probably the first great Jewish mystic in Eastern Europe. Not very well known, I must say, and that is Rabbi Moses of Kiev. Who lived at the end of the 15th and beginning of the 16th century in Kiev, now Ukraine. And here he brings his own traditions, but based on earlier traditions, probably or most definitely linked with Abulafia. And one of the reasons his book is so important, I mean, besides the fact that it's the first real Kabbalistic book in Eastern Europe, which within those centuries then became the major Jewish population center in the world, is that there is a probability that this text influenced the most important of all of the Polish rabbis. And that was, of course, Rabbi Moses Isserles of Krakow. It seems that he had some influence on Moses Isserles, who was the greatest of the Polish rabbis of the 16th century.
He wasn't a son of somebody? They didn't use that in his name?
His father was Isserles.
That was his first name? Ben Isserles?
His father's name was Isserles, or Isserlin. Or Israel, depending on how you want to pronounce it. Mm-hmm. Which was probably Israel, you know. Mm-hmm. But he was chief rabbi of Krakow and appointed by the king. And if you go to Krakow today, you can see his synagogue. The synagogue of, it's called in Hebrew the Ramah. And his grave is there.
The Ramah?
The Ramah, yeah.
Ramah.
Ramah is somebody else, Ramah. Or as they pronounce it in Polish, Remu.
Yes.
And the custom was on the anniversary of his death, which was the Jewish holiday of Lag BaOmer, for people to make a pilgrimage to his grave and to study there and pray there, probably one of the few rabbis that ever had this honor. And before the Holocaust, thousands and thousands of people would go to his grave. And if you visit his grave in Krakow today, you know there's a custom of called Hasidic custom called kvitlach, which is you write little notes, what you want and your prayers, and you put it in the tombstone or you put it in the grave on the grave, and you see these on the graves of all the famous, you know, figures. But he is so big that if you visit his grave in Krakow, he on the next to the grave has a mailbox. Because he gets so much mail.
Who was part of the Shulchan Aruch?
He was the one that wrote the commentary to the Shulchan Aruch, glosses to the Shulchan Aruch called Mapa. Shulchan Aruch means the set table. He wrote the book Mapa called Tablecloth, which added the Ashkenazic traditions, particularly the Polish traditions, to the legal code of Joseph Caro.
I'm supposed to be descended from
him.
Wow. Well, so if you go to Krakow, drop a note in his mailbox. I'm here. Say you were there. And,
the wrong idolatry.
What?
I could send
you. Mail. Could send in care of you. And save the character.
Look, now at the wall in Jerusalem, you can send fax.
A fax?
Yeah, they have a service that if you send them a fax, they'll put your prayer note in the wall for you.
I knew of this Ramo, but I never knew the name.
Oh, well, that's the name. He was very rich. It was a very rich family, and very rich family.
What was the source of the
wealth? Royal leases, banking, stuff like that. You know, the kings would give them leases on, like, the salt trade or the tolls or something like this. All right, so here is this text from Moses of Kiev. Would somebody like to read it?
Where is
it? This long indented paragraph, 23. No, the great secret.
A great secret concerning the Midrashic statement, great is the power of the prophets who make the form to resemble its former. We have already explained what seems to us to be the meaning of this secret. But then I found a passage from one of the earlier authors on this subject, and my heart urges me to record it, for it offers an explanation of the foregoing. The following is the text of that account.
All right, so he begins with a rabbinic statement from the Midrash. Great is the power of the prophets who make the form to resemble its former. In other words, the former is God. So what's clear here is he's talking about what is prophecy. And here you will see he gives a explanation, a definition, if you will, of what prophecy is that is very consonant with the ecstatic view, consonant with the Abulafian tradition, but very different than the biblical view, Talmudic view, or most philosophical views of the nature of prophecy. And here it comes.
The deeply learned Rabbi Nathan of blessed memory said to me, know that the complete secret of prophecy to a prophet consists in that he suddenly sees the form of his self standing before him, and he forgets his own self and ignores it.
Okay, so here's what this means. That the that prophecy means undergoing a process of spiritual development where the person becomes transformed, and at the height of the prophetic experience, through that transformation, the individual has a vision. We always talk about the prophets having visions, but what does the prophet have a vision of? Here is this view, that the vision is not of God, not of himself, but not simply himself, it, as you'll see by the rest. It's himself in his most realized state. In other words, it's the person in their actualized state. In other words, we live in a potential state. We have not actualized all of our potentials. But what the person achieves in the prophetic vision is a vision of themselves in their individually most idealized, fulfilled, realized state. In other words, you see yourself as you are in your most realized form. You see the real you, the best you, the most highly developed you. I don't want to say evolved. For them, there's no future and past. Time isn't an issue here. So here you have the seer and the object that's seen. The seer is you, and the object is you. And what should happen, as you'll see by the text, in this process, is a transformation of the self from who you are to who you can become. Because now you know who you really are, who you really can become, who is your own most self-actualized, your most actualized self. And the goal is for the self you are now, and somebody asked this last week, the self you are now sort of dies. It's discarded. It's no longer needed. That's your only you in your potential form. Now you can make the transition. You can bridge the gap between who you are and who you really are, or who you are at your best, who you are at your most realized dimension. And in this view, this is the definition of prophecy. that the prophet is one who has attained the level of self-realization. That the person has moved from a state, if you want it in Aristotelian language, of potentiality to actuality. That this is you in your actualized form, which means you make the transformation from your potential to your actual, and then the potential self dies, goes away. You don't need it anymore. Yeah.
So prophecy is about the person.
In this view. I'm not talking here about biblical prophecy, Talmudic views of prophecy. I'm talking about, or even in these other views, I'm talking about view in the ecstatic model or the prophetic model. This is the view of prophecy. That the prophet is one who has reached their most self-actualized state. So here you have the view that the goal of the of spiritual development is self-actualization. It's not, as in the mystical model, cohesion to God, Devekut. It's not, as in the theurgical model, making effects on what happens above. It's not, on the effective model, drawing down the divine power. It's totally anthropocentric, totally individualized, and totally focused on the individual's realization of themselves, development of themselves. The assumption, of course, is that only when the person reaches this state can they have the most intense relationship with God and the most intense vision of truth. That's another story. Mm-hmm. The goal here is the self, not the divine, and the realization of the potentials inherent within the self. And if you want to put it another way and link it to the messianic idea, it's the view that the person, through the process of spiritual development, becomes their own Messiah. In other words, when they achieve the state of prophecy, they achieve the state of messianic redemption for themselves. And in this view, for example, the idea of the restoration of the land of Israel, the rebuilding of the temple, and all these other phrases usually equated with the messianic era at the end of time in the land of Israel are all allegorized. In other words, the messianic redemption becomes a process that happens within the self as a psychological process, or a spiritual process if you want, rather than a process that occurs in time and space. So a person can rebuild the temple, come to Jerusalem, and all these other things when these things are seen allegorically, symbolically, as a state of being rather than a place in space and time.
And it's can they foresee the future?
Then they see the truth, and the future is part of the truth. But they see the future is no big deal, you know. The more big deal is that the person has realized their potential. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
My question was, when this process is obviously an incremental one, does the so-called prophet, do they feel their progress?
Let me defer answering that till we discuss the Abulafian business, because it's a very complicated thing to answer, because I would have to just give the whole lecture I'm going to give next week to answer it. All right, so let's continue.
And that form speaks with him and tells him the future.
That form being himself in the realized state. All right. Okay.
And concerning this, our sages said, great is the power of the prophets who make the form appearing to them to resemble its former, or its maker. Is that right?
Yeah. In other words, the prophet now resembles God, in a sense.
And the learned sage, Rabbi Abraham Ibn Ezra, of blessed memory, said, the one who hears at the time of prophecy is a human being, and the one who speaks is a human being.
In other words, here again you have a sort of hint to the Aristotelian view, that just because a person is born as a human being doesn't mean they're really a human being. It means they're potentially a human being. In other words, that the person doesn't really become a human being in all senses of the term until they realize their potential. Okay?
And another learned man wrote the following: "It occurred to me by the power of combination of letters of the holy names of God and by solitary meditation that I encountered that light which accompanied me, as I have discussed in the book Sha'arei Tzedek."
And this, of course, refers to Abulafia, because this is Abulafia's method and Sha'arei Tzedek is Abulafia's book. And I'll discuss next time what this means, the power of the combination of the letters and the power of solitary meditation as meditative techniques to bring about this experience of prophecy as it's defined here. Okay?
"But to see my own form standing before me, this I was not granted, and this I cannot bring about. Yet another learned man writes the following: "And I, the young one, know and acknowledge with full certainty that I am not a prophet."
24.
"Nor a son of a prophet. And I have not the Holy Spirit, and I do not make use of the heavenly voice. These things have not been vouchsafed to me. And I have not taken off my garment or washed my feet. Nevertheless, heavens are my witness and my guarantor is on high, that one day I was sitting and writing down a Kabbalistic secret when suddenly I saw the form of myself standing before me and my own self disappeared from me and I was forced and compelled to cease writing."
In other words, in the process simply of writing a Kabbalistic text, and we'll see how this fits into the Abulafian scheme, he has this prophetic experience where the self that he is encounters the self that he could be.
"Likewise, while we were composing this book and adding the vowel marks to the ineffable name of God, strange objects appeared before our eyes, like the image of red fire at sunset, until we were confused and stopped. And this happened to us several times while we were writing."
In other words, in the act of writing the divine names, you have a meditative technique that brings about this mystical experience.
Who is he talking about, the weak?
Himself.
Himself?
And probably his disciples. All right. Now we'll take an example of the theurgical view, which you'll find on page 25, and this is the Hasidic master I mentioned to you before, who lived in Berdichev in the 19th century. Berdichev is near Kiev, so we're not going geographically too far from one text to another, a few centuries. On the right side of the page, this is 25. This is Levi Yitzhak of Berdichev, who is a Hasidic master, 19th century. I quoted him earlier tonight with this Yom HaKippurim business, but...
When was the Ramu?
Ramu is in the 16th century. He died in 15, on Lag BaOmer, 1572. Right. Okay, someone like to read this one? In the dark print. "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying..."
Where is that?
Please. On the right side, dark print. Please. Was that a volunteering or a scratching? Please.
"Moses saying, speak to Aaron and to his sons, especially bless the children of Israel, say to them," says the number
This is the general principle. The Baal Shem Tov always used to rebuke people by quoting the verse, "The Lord is thy shadow," Psalms 121:5. Just as a man's shadow does whatever he does, so the Creator, blessed be he, does, as it were, whatever man does. Consequently, a man must perform good deeds, giving alms and showing compassion to the needy, so that the Creator, blessed be he, too, will bestow his goodness. This quality is called thus. For the meaning of the word thus is like this. That's to say, just as a man does, so the Creator, blessed be he, does.
So here you have it very clearly commenting on a verse in the Psalms that we and God is like the old song, me and my shadow, right? What you do, the shadow does. So if you do good things, that affects God for God to do good things. In other words, what we do here has a direct effect on God. All right, now take a look at the text on page, what is it, 31. And again here I'm using mostly Hasidic texts because they sort of represent all the traditions that came before them. So these are 18th and 19th century texts. Okay. Here you have a text from a book called the Degel Machane Ephraim, which was written by the grandson of the Baal Shem Tov, the founder of Hasidism. And this is Moses, Rabbi Moses Chaim Ephraim of Sudlikaf. And he's commenting on the verse we discussed earlier about the two great lights that God created. All right, someone like to read this one?
Everyone.
Good, thanks.
Everyone should pray for the light of the moon to be the same as the light of the sun, and for the moon to be complete, with nothing missing or diminished, for this means that there will no longer be an evil element, and all the satanic powers will be destroyed, in fulfillment of the verse which promises, "In that day shall the Lord be one, and his name one."
Okay, let's stop here for a minute, because now it gets a little complicated. As we said before, the light of the moon is diminished. So he says everybody should pray for the light of the moon to be the light of the sun. Why? Because that's the way it was in the beginning. Right? Two great lights.
Well, or before the great lights were separated out.
So separated out.
Isn't it a unity between man and woman? Because doesn't female represent the moon?
Yeah, that's part of it. But the other part is the idea that this will represent the Messianic era, when the moon is restored to her light. Because you have this idea of a kind of cyclical history, that the beginning and the end, that in the end of time, the Messianic era, you have a restoration of what you had in the beginning. So if in the beginning you had the two great lights, then at the end you also need the two great lights. I'll give you another example of the linkage between the beginning and the end. The last great person in the end is who?
In the end?
In the end. Messiah. All right? And the first person is who?
That's assuming that it was that it's a person.
I'm assuming what they assumed for our purposes. And the first person is who? Adam. Okay? So you have Adam, A, in the beginning, and Messiah at the end. Now, give you an example. You have in the 17th century in Krakow, actually buried not far in the cemetery there, not far from Moses Isilis, one of the first great Lurianic Kabbalists in Poland, Rabbi Nathan Shapiro, Natan Shapiro. He wrote a very famous book called Megale Amukot, Revealer of the Mysteries, or Revealer of the Secrets. And in there, he says like this, you have the name Adam In Hebrew, it has three letters. Aleph, Dalet, Mem. So remember that one of the major ideas of the Lurianic Kabbalists is transmigration of souls. So he says like this. This represents an abbreviation for a soul that transmigrates into three people, the same soul. Who are the three people? Adam, David, Messiah. And then he says, look at the letters. I'll do it in print rather than script in Hebrew. The first letter is the Aleph, abbreviation for Adam, Adam. So see, the letter is open. See? There are holes in the letter. So you have a possibility of a movement to the next person. The next person is who? David. See? It's open. So you have a possibility to the next person. And then at the end, you have the final mem, closed, Messiah. That's the end. Now, the idea is that the Messiah that comes at the end is the same soul as Adam who becomes in the beginning. In other words, that Adam and the Messiah are the same soul. In other words, that the Messiah puts everything back the way it was in the time of Adam before Adam sinned. Or if you want it in the Lurianic system, Adam is the fire with all the sparks, and Messiah is all the same fire with all the sparks put back together again. That's the doctrine of Tikkun, where you put everything back together.
When they talk about David, do they include his sins?
When they talk about David?
Why do they put David in there?
Because David is the same soul as the Messiah, and this is as Adam, and he's the ancestor of the Messiah. Now the question you're asking, what is the link between David and Adam? The link is in a midrash. It's a very famous midrash. And the midrash goes like this. God took Adam and showed him a valley. And in this valley were all of the souls of all future people ever to be born. Okay? So Adam is walking in this valley, all the souls, and they're like little fires, little flames, each soul. He's walking along, he comes to a soul, and it's flickering very faintly. So Adam says to God, why is this flickering very faintly? And God says, because this child will die right after it's born. So Adam says to God, well, what if it lives? What will it do, this child? And God says to Adam, well, it'll be King David. He'll write the Psalms. He'll have this fling with Bathsheba. And his descendant, the Messiah, will undo, repair the sin that you, Adam, are going yet to commit. So Adam says, I need to do something about this. So he says to God, all right, God, how long am I going to live? So God says, you're going to live one day. So Adam then, in Midrash, everything is possible, right? Adam quotes the Psalms, where it says, a day in your sight, God, is like 1,000 years. Or no, 1,000 years in your sight is like a day. So in other words, a day in God time is 1,000 years. So Adam will live 1,000 years. Now you look in the Bible, how long did Adam live? 930 years. So this interprets, why did Adam live 930 years? Why not 1,000 years? Because he gave 70 years of his life to David, and David lived exactly 70 years. According to the tradition, he was born on the holiday of Shavuot, and he died exactly 70 years later on the holiday of Shavuot. So they have the same soul. Adam gave him part of his soul. So Adam and David are the same soul, same person, and Messiah is descendant of David, and therefore has the same soul. OK, Okay, so this idea, you see it expressed in many different forms throughout the literature, that the end is the same as the beginning. For example, what's paradise in Hebrew? One term for paradise, Gan Eden, Garden of Eden. Where is Adam in the beginning, before the sin? Garden of Eden. So the beginning and the end are sort of parallel. You have a kind of cycle. So when the moon is complete, namely when the moon representing the Shekhinah is redeemed, then you have the Messianic era. And when you have the Messianic era, there will no longer be an evil element. And the satanic powers, namely the Sitrach, or the other side, will be destroyed. And all of this is their interpretation of a verse, this verse from Zechariah, which you may recognize because it's in the prayer of the Aleinu. Bayom hahu yihyeh Adonai echad ushmo echad. On that day, the Lord will be one and his name one. What do they take it to mean? They take it to mean that now, in historical times, now, God is not one. On that day, the Messianic day, then he'll be one. But if he's going to be one on that day, unified on that day, the implication is that today, which is not that day, he's not one.
Right. Meaning that the rest of the people don't believe in him.
Not don't believe. He's not one. Then he'll be one. Now he's not one. The question is, how do you make that transition from him not being one to him being one? Our job. Okay? So that's how they interpret this verse. On that day, God will be one in his name one. Meaning, in Messianic times, he'll be one. Now he's not one. To make the transition from him not being one to being one, that's for us to do. Okay. Now what?
Does the Messianic age mean to us that we're getting a second chance to do a better job in the Garden of Eden?
It depends which view of the Messianic age you take.
Here
you don't have a second chance. Okay, now let's see what else he has to say. Now it gets a little difficult.
The meaning of this verse is as follows. The holy name will be composed of the letters Yod He Yod He.
And now it's composed of what letters?
Yod He Vav He.
Yod He Vav He. And what is the verse? Bayom Hahu Yihyeh. Yod He Yod He. On that day, God's name will be Yihyeh, which means he will be. On that day, Messianic day, it won't be Yod He Vav He like it is now, the ineffable four letter name of God. It'll be Yod He Yod He. Just like in this verse, Yihyeh Adonai Echad Ushmo Echad. Okay?
There will no longer be a separation between the Vav and the He, like the one between Yod and He. And then the word
Me'orot means the light,
which is now spelled without a Vav, will be completed by the addition of a Vav.
Okay, so in the verse that they're quoting, the light of the sun and the light of the moon, the Hebrew word for light, how is he translated here? Yeah, light. Me'orot is spelt like this. And the O sound, me'orot, is indicated simply by that dot. But in the Messianic period, it will be spelled what is called in Hebrew full, malay, with the letter vav. See? Now it's spelled without it in the Bible. Now, then it'll be spelled with it. And that will be the vav from God's ineffable name.
What about a vav after the resh?
Oh, maybe that's where it goes. I don't spell too well. No, in the text there is one after the resh. There's not one over here, I think. If you look in the text, I think that's the one that's missing. I don't spell well in any language. And how did I figure this out? Yeah. And then, you'll have the letter He, which they say like this. The letter He, which is the H, has two parts, this part and this part, right? This part, if you make it bigger, looks like the Vav. And this part, if you make it smaller, it looks like the Yud. See? So the hay, the stick, this part will go up here, and then this part will come over here, and you'll have your here.
Yeah, and then psychoactive drugs, use non-mystics.
Evidence of psychoactive drug use? No, that was the whole trick. You can have all this stuff without the drug use.
I'm just curious.
I'll tell you, there was a big debate. Sure, they had hallucinations.
You don't need drugs to have that kind of effect. You
should
do it by fasting, lack of sleep.
Right.
You know, things of that sort. Meditating.
There's a famous book written by, you know who Aldous Huxley was?
Sure.
The British writer, Brave New World, all this stuff. He wrote a book called Doors of Perception, mm-hmm. which discussed the effects of taking, I think it's mescaline. And what is lesser known than his book is that Martin Buber wrote a response to Huxley's book, Doors of Perception,
wow.
in which he says, I think it's in Buber's book in English called The Knowledge of Man, which is a collection of his essays, in which he says, essentially, in a more elegant way than I'm going to put it now, what's the big trick of having all these experiences when you're popping all these drugs? The bigger trick is to have them without popping the drugs.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if you can get the same experiences through sort of natural technique, why do you need these quickie methods that also have downsides?
Mm-hmm.
So if you take someone like Caro, who I mentioned to you before, Joseph Caro, he has a book called Magid Me Sharim. It's sort of a mystical autobiography in which he talks about his mystical experiences, amongst other things. And there's some wild stuff in there. Now, if you consider that here is a guy who, if he slept more than 2 hours a night, thought himself lazy, and if he ate more than a few grains of something during the day, considered himself a glutton, try it for a few months, and see if you don't have visions and stuff like this.
Right.
Plus, you add certain meditative techniques.
Right.
You know? It would be strange if you didn't have strange things happening to you.
And they knew about the alpha state early.
They knew about a lot of things that, you know, now everybody thinks are new discoveries.
Right.
I know that there are Kabbalists in Jerusalem today who have perfected certain methods that they actually have a physical aura coming out of their body, that their skin actually shines. They become translucent.
Did you see?
Yes.
Did you see it?
I didn't see it, no. But I know people who did see it.
Can you trust
them? The people I can trust.
Who we have this aura?
These Kabbalists in Jerusalem today.
Did anyone take a photograph and see
it? No, they wouldn't allow photographs. But you know, we have an expression in English, you know, oh, you're shining today, you know, something like this. The effects of drugs in the brain that have an effect on your, you know, physiological state. You have a tremendous endorphin release. You know, you want to do it with a drug, you want to do it with a meditative technique, it'll have the same effect. Jug, I'm not so sure whether you can get that, whether you'll be translucent. Maybe if you lose enough weight, you'll be translucent from jogging.
Well, arsenic does that.
Well,
that doesn't mean you can't commune with that, though.
No, it doesn't mean it at all.
Physiological.
Well, that's one of the points that Buber made in his article against Huxley. He said, you know, it completely takes you out of the realm of the relational. You don't have relation to anybody except to this drug. All right, let's go.
the vav is a symbol of the tree of life and stands for the emanations flowing from the tree, for all life, blessing, and goodness emanate from the tree of life, and the divine emanation received by the tree flows from the divine light that enlightens it.
Okay. Okay, let's finish it off.
If something is missing from the light that flows down to the tree of life, it will also be missing from the divine emanation that in turn flows from the tree. The Shekhinah is called moon because she has no light of her own, just as the moon receives all its light from the sun. Symbolically, the Shekhinah is like a mirror. She does not have her own source of light, and whatever light she receives from comes from God.
In other words, we go back to what we discussed before of the Seder plate. The Shekhinah is the plate. In other words, the plate reflects everything on the plate. Shekhinah doesn't have any substance of her own, and the flow down, all the flow down culminates in her, so she reflects what comes down, she reflects back up. And then going the other way, it's like a window. Going up, it's like a mirror, but going down, it's like a window where the flow goes through.
Do they have a visual image of the tree of life?
They have a few.
Can you identify some of the trees?
First of all, the trees are usually upside down. Mm-hmm. Because the idea is that the roots are above, not below. See, in a tree, you draw a tree. I'm not very good at drawing. If you draw a tree, you have the roots on the bottom, right? And the leaves on the top. But their idea is it's an upside down tree because everything is rooted in the upper world. So the tree is upside down. That's the most important part of the tree.
Like it gets its nourishment from above.
Right.
Do they use a palm tree?
Palm tree is one of their favorite trees because it was considered a hermaphroditic tree. Yes. Tamar in Hebrew can be either masculine or feminine. This says that? No, this doesn't say that, but other things say that. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's finish it off. So Shekhinah is like a mirror reflecting what's above.
Mm-hmm. Well, when the ultimate union of the Shekhinah and God takes place with nothing missing and nothing lacking, all the emanations of goodness and blessing will completely and freely descend. And then all the evil powers and all the satanic elements will be.
Okay, so when everything is back together, when Shekhinah and Tiferet are reunited, then the flow from above down below goes the way it's supposed to go without any interference from the other side, from the demonic. Everything flows the way it's supposed to flow. And that's that. So the story has a happy ending. Now one final text is the one on page 30. If you take a look on the left side of the page, this is a commentary on the story of Noah, man's influence on the divine. And this text is especially influenced by the Lurianic Kabbalah. Someone like to read this? Yeah?
Noah was in his generation a man righteous, tzaddik, and wholehearted, Genesis. Similarly, in every generation there is a tzaddik who is the foundation of the world. Take special note of the one thought which will awaken your hearts to perform Yehudim in the divine world, for this expression refers to eating.
So here, Noah is called in Hebrew tzaddik, and of course the Hasidic master was called tzaddik, righteous. You have the verse, the tzaddik, the righteous one, is the foundation. So the tzaddik was, the Hasidic tzaddik was identified with the biblical reference to the tzaddik. The tzaddik is the foundation in the biblical verse. In the Proverbs, the Hebrew term for foundation is yesod, tzaddik yesod olam. So the tzaddik was identified with which of the sfirot? Obviously, yesod. Yesod is related to which part of the celestial analogy, anatomy? The phallus. So it's the pipe, it's the flow from the upper world to our world. And that's the role of the tzaddik. That's the role of the righteous person. So if the tzaddik isn't present, or if there's something wrong with what they're doing, then the flow does not come. And that's really bad news. Furthermore, you have here the idea, in every generation there is a tzaddik who is the foundation of the world. In other words, that the same quality of people we had in the biblical period, can have today. For the Hasidic, for the followers of the Hasidic masters, their master was as great as Moses, or in this case, as great as Noah. That the tzaddik today could do what the tzaddik in the biblical times, in this case Noah, could do, and that is act as the channel for the divine flow to come from above. Now, how is that flow done? By the act called in the Lurianic system Yehudim, which mean acts of unification, which mean that you do certain acts that bring about the unification of the male and female forces within the divine. And as I mentioned to you, you have that what's called Kavanah, little prayer before the prayer, where you say, I'm going to do this act or say this prayer, Al Yehud Kucha Brichu Ushchinte, for the unification of the Holy One, blessed be He, which refers to Tiferet, and Shekhinah. So Yichud is a unifying act that brings about the unification of the male and female elements within God. And when that happens, you have, again, the sacred intercourse, whatever you want to call it, and as a result of that, you have the possibility of the divine flow from above to below. And the channel through which the divine flow, one of the channels that comes, is through the tzaddik, who is analogized to, or is viewed as corresponding to, the ninth of the emanations, namely Yisod. Okay? Oh. And here he says an example of the Yichud is eating. In other words, you would think these Yehudim, these mystical acts that bring about, you know, the unifications above, is some, you know, esoteric thing. He says, no, it's not an esoteric thing. Simply eating your dinner can bring about these Yehudim if you do it the right way. Yeah.
So then the origin of the custom is in Yehud after a couple is married to break bread together?
No, that's something altogether different. The Yichud after the couple is married is that the presumption, I won't say the assumption, the presumption is that an intercourse has taken place since they're alone together, right after the wedding, and that the marriage has been consummated, the new home has been established. And that's why the custom is to have a little symbolic meal in there as the symbol that the new household, the new family, has been established.
So it has nothing to do with this?
No, nothing to do with this. Okay.
Anything in the world can help to cause Yehudim in the divine world. If these things cause you to awaken, hinting at the divine wisdom that causes the descent of the divine plenty and awakens your heart to the worship of God, you will be able to bring about an increase in the divine plenty and light so that there is more.
So here you have an example of the effective model, that simply by eating the right way, you bring about an effect above that causes the flow to come from above to below through the tzaddik, who is the channel. And that any kind, you see the phrase that's important here, anything in the world, in other words, any kind of action has the potential of bringing down the flow. Any kind of action, from such a simple action as eating. Okay?
It sounds like you, this increase in the divine plenty and light, also there's a reaction upstairs as well.
Right, right.
To put it briefly, every Jew has the ability to perform Yehudim in the divine world in accordance with the power of his knowledge and spiritual achievements, uplifting all the holy letters from all the creatures in the world.
In other words, this doesn't refer necessarily to an elite. Everybody has the ability to do this. It's not like you have to, you know, undergo all kinds of, you know, mystical training and stuff like this. Everybody has the ability to do this. And the more knowledge you have, the more spiritual attainments you have, the better you're able to do it. But everybody has the possibility of doing it. Okay?
All the creatures were created by the holy letters of the Torah and returned to the place from whence they came, causing divine light to flow to these stages in the divine world.
Okay, if we had time, I'd say a lot about this, but we don't, so I just want to finish this up.
This applies only to a wise man who fears God and worships truly with all his might, directing his every effort and all the details of his worship to pleasing God. Such a person can really gather the letters of the Torah from everything in the world, even from a simple conversation with another person. Someone who does not have an expanding mind cannot do this, although he can unify himself with the letters of the Torah when he studies or prays.
Here, one of the underlying assumptions is that in the letters there is a divine spark, a divine presence. And the goal is to achieve some kind of communion with the divine presence in the letters of the Torah or in the letters of prayer. So let me conclude with one other observation that relates to this text, the biblical text they're commenting on, which is the Noah story. God tells Noah to enter the ark, and I think I mentioned this to you last week. In Hebrew, the same word for ark, teva, is the word for letter. So the Hasidic masters, Baal Shem Tov says, what does it mean? When God says to Noah, enter the ark, it means everybody is Noah, and everybody can enter the teva. Everybody can enter the letter. In other words, when the person studies or when the person prays, they can achieve communion with God by the vehicle of the sacred text, the sacred letter. So therefore, one of the vehicles for achieving dveikut was study of the Torah, because you're dealing with the sacred words, and prayer, because you're dealing with the sacred words. Because in the words, the idea is you should meet God. And this Moses Chaim Ephraim of Sidlikov, who I mentioned to you before, has a very similar idea, commenting on the verse in Exodus, where it says, God says, you should make me a sanctuary that I shall dwell amongst you. You have this verse on many synagogues. And he interprets it, doesn't refer to a synagogue. It refers to the Torah. I'm sorry, it refers to the individual self. That the self should be the sanctuary. And I, God, should dwell inside you. And he says, how is this possible? And his answer is, through the communion with the letters of the Torah. That the letters of the Torah serve as a kind of catalyst, a vehicle to communion with the divine, because the God is in the letters. You see, it's exactly the opposite of what you have in the New Testament. In the New Testament, the Gospel of John, you have it says, and the Word was God, right? Here you have it the opposite way. First, God is in the Word. The Word doesn't become God. God becomes the Word. God is in the Word. And the meeting place for us and God, one of them is in the Word. The other one, as you have in the effect in the ecstatic model, is in the self. Okay, so next time what we'll do is to begin to discuss the different methods by which the Kabbalists used to achieve these different goals and destinations exemplified by these four models.